Interdependence Day.
Yeah. Oh, Interdependence Day. Oh, great. Okay. That would be good. In Sanskrit, Bhagavati Pradya Parvita Hridaya. In Tibetan, Chomden Dema Sherapache Nimbo. In English, Blessed Lady Buddha, Transcendent Wisdom Heart. Thus did I hear on a special occasion the Blessed Lord was dwelling on the vulture peak at Rajagriha, together with the great communities of mendicants and bodhisattvas. At that time, the Blessed Lord entranced himself in the teaching Samadhi Hall, illumination of the profound. Just then, the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, was contemplating the practice of the profound transcendence of wisdom, and he realized that those five body-mind processes are void of any intrinsic reality. Thereupon, impelled by the power of the Buddha, Venerable Shariputra, addressed the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, thus: when any noble son wishes to engage in the practice of the profound transcendence of wisdom, how should he learn? Then the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, addressed the Venerable Shariputra thus: Shariputra, when any noble son or noble daughter wishes to engage in the practice of the profound transcendence of wisdom, he or she should realize it in this way. Those five body-mind processes should be truly realized to be void of any intrinsic reality. Matter is voidness. Voidness is matter. Voidness is not other than matter. Neither is matter other than voidness. Likewise, sensations, conceptions, mental functions, and consciousnesses are also void. Shariputra, thus all things are voidness, silence, uncreated, unceased, stainless, impeccable, undecreased, and unincreased. Shariputra, thus in voidness there are no matter, no sensation, no conception, no mental function, no consciousness. No eye, no ear, no nose, no tongue, no body, no mentality, no form or color, no sound, no scent, no taste, no texture, no idea. There are no sense media from eye to mentality sense media, and there are no consciousness media from visual to mental consciousness media either. There are no ignorance and no cessation of ignorance and so on, up to no old age and death, and no cessation of old age and death either. Likewise, there are no suffering, no origination, no creation, no path, no intuitive wisdom, no attainment, and no non-attainment either. Therefore, Shariputra, because the Bodhisattva is without attainment, she lives in reliance on transcendent wisdom. His spirit is unobscured and free of fear. Passing far beyond all confusion, she ultimately succeeds in nirvana. And all the Buddhas who live in past, present, and future rely on transcendent wisdom to reach manifested perfect Buddhahood and unexcelled perfect enlightenment. Such being so, there is the mantra of transcendent wisdom, the mantra of great science, the unexcelled mantra, the uniquely universal mantra, the mantra that eradicates all suffering. It is not false and should be known as truth, the transcendent wisdom mantra, as follows: Tajata. Om Gate Gate Para Gate Para Sangate Bodhisattva. Om Gate Gate Para Gate Para Sangate Bodhisattva. Om Gate Gate Para Gate Para Sangate Bodhisattva. Shariputra, thus should the Bodhisattva, the great hero, learn the profound transcendence of wisdom. Thereupon the Blessed Lord arose from that samadhi and applauded the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero. Excellent, excellent, noble son, so it is, so it is. One should practice the profound transcendence of wisdom in just the way you have taught it, and even the transcendent Buddhas will joyfully congratulate you when the Blessed Lord has spoken thus, the Venerable Sharadatiputta, the Noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the Great Hero, and everyone in that audience and the whole world with its gods, humans, titans, and fairies rejoiced and all applauded what the Buddha said. But they always say, by the way, great hero after Avalokiteshvara's name, because it always was Bodhisattva Mahasattva. Those two always go together. Because the Bodhisattva, the hero of enlightenment for oneself, because enlightenment is the fulfillment of oneself. And then the great hero is the one who seeks the enlightenment of everyone else. So they always put them together to indicate that you're not being a martyr by seeking the enlightenment of everybody else, and that you're not forgetting about everybody else by seeking the enlightenment. And all kind of chakra mandala. I don't know that we'll see that. I'm sorry, I'm just so lazy today. Oh, that's it. That's not the kind of chakra mandala, but in case anyone didn't know, this is a computer rendering of a more simple mandala, Anexcel Yoga Tantra mandala. I think of the Ikavira Yamantaka mandala. But it's not, it doesn't all look, in other words, it's not texture, the wall, the ornaments, and all. But it's the three-dimensionality. And these buildings are transparent. The walls are made of diamond, ruby, emerald, and so on. You can see through them all. Not encrusted with diamonds and rubies, but slabs of diamond, impossible materials. And that's what those kind of diagrams mean. When this Kalachakra mandala has three buildings, one inside another, if you can see. In a way, four, because there's a penthouse. This here in the center is a penthouse, actually. And the gates over the buildings are these things that are lying flat here like that. And the outer rings are, this is because this is an entire universe. It is not something located in this universe. It's a different universe. And these are Vajra flames, and this is a wall of Vajra bullets. And then this is earth and fire, wind and fire and earth and water and earth. Those four colors there. And that means that the elements of this other universe are there, and then there's this palace in the center of it. So it's a solitary palace in the middle of a different universe, is the idea. So when you go on Shunyata Jnana Vajra, how many of you did that meditation? Did anybody do that? You feeling like a Buddha today? How does the Buddha feel? The Buddha must worry a lot about Donald Trump. And maybe not. Maybe yes, maybe not. I don't know. I think so. And I think he leaves it to the Bodhisattvas to worry, I think. when you learn that, there are seven, in this particular mandala, there are 722 deities in it. Bodhisattvas, Buddhas, and actually gods, what they call Lokapalas, world protectors, and so on. That's where Mr. and Mrs. Indra, Mr. and Mrs. Vishnu, Mr. and Mrs. Shiva, Mr. and Mrs. Ganesha, Mr. and Mrs. Rudra, they're all in there. And all the Vedic speech goddesses like Savitri are all in there. It's very, very, and this tantra supposedly was rediscovered from Shambhala, which is a mythical tantra somewhere in the North Pole or something. Nobody knows where, because it's hidden. And it was rediscovered in around the same time that the Shaivites in Kashmir were really wailing, really doing great work. And it's very interactive with it, with the Shaivite thing in Kashmir. And Vaishnavite tantra also. But Abhinavagupta, who wrote the tantra Mala, I think. And Mala Saroja, something like that. Malini, Saroja Malini, something like that. And another couple of tantra, a couple of really important tantra works. He quotes the Kalachakra tantra. And the Kalachakra people do refer to the Shaivites. And back and forth. And so there was a time, I think, when there was like a common culture at the Siddha level. These little Sanskrit letters that you see going around in a circle, they indicate the eight smashanas. Each one of the wheels is one of the eight smashanas, which symbolizes the ordinary part of this other universe. And those things are the days of the month, they're the astrological signs, the lunar mansions, the planets, etc. They're all kind of things like that. The whole cosmos. It's really an entire amazing cosmos. Anyway, and so when you meditate that, when you do you go that shunyata jnana vajra sabhavatma koham, and then you rise out of the pure potential of clear light of the void. When you say that, you let yourself melt into clear light blissfully, and you become infinite, etc., by visualization at least. And then you arise from that in the form of, say, the Kalachakra couple, and then you surround yourself with a holographic mansion like the, whoops, mansion like, well, that's just, well, yeah, that was a video of showing that, but it's not active. So. And you arise like this, like the Kalachakra form, and you have four faces, which are many different sets of four. You know, they're the four seasons, they're the four noble truths, they're the four different philosophical stances, you know, realism, nominalism, idealism, and relativism. They're the four Vedas. Actually, they relate to the four Vedas. They dare to relate them to everything in Brahmanism and Vedism. And you have 24 arms, and you have three shoulders, and 12 upper arms, and 24 lower, you know, forearms and hands. And then that means you have 360 fingers, I think. And that means that you have all the days of the lunar year that they represent, you know, your fingers, etc. I mean, everything is a symbol of time. And then your female side, which could be a consort if you're practicing with a partner who is equally trained as you are, you cannot just do it with just anybody off the street. If you do, you could be just yourself and be both the male and female sides yourself. You could be just yourself and have a consort who would appear like an angelic form, like a subtle body form, and you would only meet her in your subtle body form. There's all kinds of varieties of it, actually. She has eight arms and four faces also. And she represents, I think, getting down to practicality. Because it doesn't need 24 arms. You represent time as an ultimate reality. And I always like to say the Kalachakra form is really most amazingly elaborate. It's said to be the most elaborated and the most explicit unexcelled yoga tantric form, according to the Tibetans. It's so much so that at first, when it was introduced into Tibet, some of the Tibetans thought this may not be Buddhist tantra, and they were kind of worried about it. But it is that. But what it represents to me is the Buddha fulfilling his bodhisattva vow. In other words, he showed this form to show someone how to become a Buddha and fulfill the bodhisattva vow. Because the bodhisattva vow is, I will not achieve nirvana, perfect total bliss of Buddhahood and nirvana, until all beings have achieved that. And then they say there are three ways of doing that, like a cowherd, like a ferryman, and like a king. And the cowherd one is where, you know, you put all the cows into the pasture and then you come in and close the gate. So you put them all in first, right? And the ferry boat man is like where you all land on the bank of the other shore at the same time as your passengers. You know, the boat lands and everybody's at the other shore. And the king is where the king goes first and then brings the whole community with him. And while the first one represents the sort of intention of the bodhisattva, the third one represents the practical reality of the matter, how to execute the thing, because obviously you can't bring people into perfect enlightenment until you know what it is yourself, and you can't really know what it is yourself until you attain it, right? So that's the solution. So what the Kalachakra shows, but then when you attain Buddhahood, as I think I said the other day, but to emphasize in this context, when you attain Buddhahood, your mind doesn't just expand to be one with all things infinitely spatially. it also expands to be one with all moments of time, temporally. So you're everywhere in space-time, in other words. And therefore, you are in every moment of the future, just like even in the Theravada story of the Buddhists, the Pali text, the Buddha remembers infinite previous lives and is aware of infinite future lives of other beings. But they don't say how he engages with that memory, simply has it in it. I guess they think he freaks out at such a degree of entanglement and attains nirvana quickly to get the hell out of there. And maybe the way they assume it is. But from the point of view of, but he already said that, you see. And obviously, if you're in that, there's two things. One, there's no question, the Buddhists do not say that everyone's future is determined by some kind of mechanical fate. Like that, you know, there was, in fact, that was a school that existed in India at the time, among the six major schools of the Shramanas, the seekers, the vacationers, as I call them. Some people call them the ascetics. Among the six schools, Jainism was one, Buddhism was one, and then there were a bunch of them, and one of them was the fatalists. And the teacher of that, I forget his name, but his name is known, but he used to have a lecture he would give where he had a ball of twine. And he would reach the high moment of his lecture, and then he would throw the ball of twine, and it would unravel until it was completely unraveled, and then it would fall to the ground. So that was his illustration, that you don't have to make effort to become enlightened, because it will just automatically happen by the time comes. But that didn't last too long. The people were not satisfied with the result. And etc. One of them was like a nihilist. There are six of them, you know, in all of Buddhist texts. So the point is that if, therefore, the Buddha was aware of all the other future potentialities of all the other beings, then to fulfill his bodhisattva vow, he had to manifest in this crazy idea the Buddhists have, that when you become this infinite, you become this conscious infinity of energy, you can manifest whatever you want out of that infinity of energy. Except your power is limited, you're not omnipotent, because your power is limited in the sense that you cannot force any other being to achieve that mind instantaneously. It's, you know, you can't, you're not a bliss bomb that blows everybody else into the blissful merger with the clear light of the void, into Buddhahood. Because why? Because in a way, you do have infinite energy because there is this quiescent infinite energy according to the clear light of the void, like the Satchitananda. I think it's the same Brahman field of the Satchitananda. But and you can, since you're one with all of it, you can shape anything you want out of it, including continuing to shape what seemed to have been your something like your previous body. But your compassion, therefore, lets you know the exact sensitivity of all the beings that are in this infinity with you. And those who are, and of course there are infinite Buddhas in the same place with you, and they're fine, you don't worry about them. But the ones who are suffering there, each one needs a specific treatment. Each one needs a specific path of evolution. And the preposterous claim is, I mean, preposterous from our sort of materialist, lowly expectation type of attitudes, is that you can manifest whatever it takes to optimally bring whoever it is and whatever it is toward their own fulfillment, which will be identical to your fulfillment when they achieve it, except that it will be they personally who will be enjoying it as you are enjoying it, type of thing. And that's called the nirmanakaya, the body of emanation. Nirmana means to emanate something. So then you can emanate. The gods can emanate too. They can emanate whole armies full of soldiers and things like that. They do, but they're not quite limitless according to the Buddhist thing. Whereas a Buddha or a god who becomes a Buddha is limitless in their ability to do that. They claim. So, and it's in a way it kind of has to do it, because since you're one with the suffering beings, although, and then again, it's not that you, your sensitivity, your compassion, empathy, and sensitivity gets bogged into their suffering. It's again a little paradoxical, because you are completely aware of exactly their suffering and exactly what's causing it and exactly how they themselves have to do whatever to open it up and to open up to the actual their own reality. But at the same time, you see their own reality, so you see them in their contortion of suffering having through ignorance, their ignorance has shaped their constitution of bliss, void, indivisible, which is what they really are, bliss, freedom, indivisible. You know, they're all July 4th beings, totally free, but, so you see them simultaneously already cured, but had taking time to reach their own awareness of being cured. So then your compassion forces you to emanate into all those future crossroads, places where they have free choice and make decisions, you know, and be whatever it takes to sort of nudge them in the right directions without being able to force them to do anything. So therefore, this body, with these 24 arms and all these fingers, and with 722 colleagues, which include all the gods, actually, all the known ones in India at the time, you know. Poor old Yahweh is not, he's not hanging out because he doesn't know about it. You know, he's stuck in the desert of India. But, you know, Yahweh and a few others, you know. But the Indian ones are all there. They're totally there. And their wives are there. Absolutely. No one is on their own. Like, you know, making whatever, Shiva, like, you know, making third eye blasts. You know, remember how the gods were afraid Shiva would destroy the universe with his third eye after Parvati died? He was so upset. So they sent her his reincarnation over to try to get him to calm down. Remember that? Okay. So in other words, it's the idea of time. It's different. The wonderful vision that Krishna showed in the Bhagavad Gita, where he showed Mahakala, time the destroyer, which it is, right? It's death, you know, like we come to old age and death. So he was showing, he was reassuring Arjuna that he's the one responsible for the deaths of all the soldiers and things when he's going to fight the battle. If you remember that vision, I think in the 11th chapter. I think, I forget. Exactly. And so that's time the destroyer. But here, what time is made by compassion into the field, like the greenhouse, you know, like the fields for the flowering of the individual beings into their full evolutionary potential, which is called Buddhahood. Has nothing to do with religion or anything like that. It just has to do with this vision of evolution. It's actually a scientific proposition, in fact. But it's an amazing, I think it's an amazing symbol. I personally really do love it. I do. And in some ways, it is said like Samaja, Chakrasambara, and Yamantaka, and things like that are more yogically something or other. This one is. But there's something really special about this one. I feel it has all of their elements in it myself. I really like that. There is a Lone Ranger form, a Kavira form, a Lone Ranger form of Kavachakra called Vajra Vega and Vajra Force, you know. So I used to tease George Lucas and say, oh, you discovered the force, did you? What do you mean? He said, well, I thought you found that in the Kavachakra Tantra, didn't you? He says, oh, I never heard that. Well, and then he said, force isn't really good, he said. And I said, oh, George, you know, the people who really align with the force, good ones, they're a little stronger, right? You know? And I was trying to encourage him because he was upset about the movie that was made without him, the recent one. A little upset. Did you see it? But see, what I took was I went to the moment, wasn't the beautiful moment of that movie, was where the girl, you know, who's the granddaughter of somebody, daughter of somebody, she's much weaker than that guy, you know, that nasty look behind. You know? And yet she's holding him off like this. And then she goes in and she remembers the old lady who said, well, the force is beautiful, you know, just let it go, you know. And then suddenly she has this super strength, right? Flings him all over the place. She's the gentle one, but she has the greater strength. I was really great. I'm sorry. I try to encourage him. This is the penthouse occupants of the Kalachakra. This is called the Great Bliss Circle. And in that there, those are the eight Shaktis, they're called, the Numas. And always in the Tantric Mandala, in the Buddhist thing, the east is always the down thing, rather than south, you know. And so the north is on the right side, the left side of the central deity. And the south is on the right side. So these are the eight Shaktis, eight-armed goddesses in this with the Kalachakra. And Vishwamata, the name of Mrs. Kalachakra, is Vishwamata, Universal Mother. She's like Prajnaparamita in that sense. And this one I thought you'd like to think was fun. This is Tibetan, a Tibetan version of our chakras. But don't worry about it. Like, don't... I have always this. Because this is software, you know, not hardware. In other words, there is hardware in there, but the chakra images that you have, and I know you probably know some from Hatha Yoga development, they are as well, which are fairly similar mostly. They have different syllables and there's some differences. But they are ways of structuring the sensitivity in the central nervous system. And for example, Kala Chakra is a little different from some of the others. The top one there is actually a little bit above your normal head. It's not inside your coarse body. It's above, if you had an Ushnisha, what is called an Ushnisha, which if you notice, Buddha has this extra, I call it the extra scoop of brain he has up there, has an extra scoop up there, like a little tower on top of the crown of his head. And if you had one, that would be that chakra with four petals, four openings on there. And then the next one down is the crown chakra, which is a little different than it is in other traditions. And then the next one, the very complex one there, is the throat chakra because of the speech thing. It's a 32-petal one, and the 16 is the one above. Well, usually the throat is 16 and the brain is 32, but this time the brain is that. And then the heart chakra is next down. That's only 8 petals. And then the 64-petal navel chakra is the next one down. And finally, there's the genital chakra, secret chakra, which is also 32 petals. And then the central channel is going there, and they somehow make a face out of it. It's interesting. And you know, as you were doing that, right? The right channel, which the Buddhists call the rasana, and the left one, which they call the lalana, which I think you guys call the idan pingala, right? And then the sushumna, the central channel, which is the avadhuti, the Buddhists call avadhuti, goes down, and then in normal people, that's another kala chakra. Oh, that's one thing. We don't need that. I want to find this other thing. I'm sorry. Don't get dizzy. Don't look at it. I want to find another thing. Oh yeah. Well, that's nice because it sort of gives you a sense of what it feels like when you visualize. You know, if you visualize that purifying breath thing where you go in your right nostril and in your left nostril, etc. If you visualize yourself having this plumbing in there, central channel is in the middle, the purplish thing, coming out to third eye point, and then these two will come out down to the two nostrils, and they go down. This one has it just going to the navel. It's just trying to show how it feels up above. And actually it goes all the way down to perineum and out to the tip of the genitalia. Male or female. And but then there's another picture of medical. That's the Tibetan medicine one showing this one doesn't have the Kala Chakra one on the top. It just has five of them, which is the more usual one. And then this is what I'm showing. This is another version of it, of the one without the Kala Chakra. This is Guhya Samaja. But you see this, where the right and left ones loop around? You see the loops on the left of this picture? And then the looping around, there's a lot of looping around there in the middle, you see? And then there's a loop around, and it doesn't really show, because it's only going to the navel chakra, it's only showing four chakras. So it has to go to the genital one. But all the chakras but the heart chakra have one loop of the right one, and one loop of the left one, the red one, the white one, that pinch off the openness of the central channel. So the ordinary person does not experience energy or feel energy in the central channel. Except a little bit when they pass out, when they have orgasm. Those are the only two times, because that's when the energy goes to one of the other openings of the central channel. I'm talking a very ordinary person, not necessarily a yogi. And of course at death, then everyone dies. And the reason that's looped off for the ordinary person is that then the heart one has what's called a six-fold knot, which often is what is symbolized by the double triangle interpenetrating two triangles, like the Shiva Shakti thing, is the sixfold knot. And that's very tight and very difficult to unravel, that is. And that's because that's holding the subtle life force, the super subtle body-mind, in the center of that sixfold knot, in the central channel, in like a little chamber there, between the three upper loops and the three lower loops. And here they're showing the loops as if they are loose. You see there's six loops there. You see two red ones and a white one below the center. Doesn't show the center part. And then two white ones and a red one above. And the white one is associated with the male and with semen. The red one is associated with the female and with what I call ovum. In the text they say blood simply, and this gives, people the wrong idea that it's just blood. But it's actually the fertile part of blood that produces eggs, you know, in the ovary. I don't know what you call that in English, actually. Did you ever find that? Did any of the corpses let you? Female corpses? Was there a name for that? Because it's not, no ordinary blood obviously is not going to be fertile, right? So the fertility thing is some kind of subtle substance. And that's what they're talking about. And that I call it ovum. But I don't know if there is a name for it in medicine. Any doctors here know the name? So there, in semen, there's sperm, right? That's the fertile element in the semen, right? But there's what is the fertile element in special type of blood that the ovary works on?
Estrogen.
And then can be, when it doesn't work out, it gets released in menstruation. But ordinary blood goes with that too. So there's something special in the blood, that's what I'm saying. That's very important to know. Because some people who wrongly interpret Tantra, they think Tantra was some sort of giant, multi-thousand-year slurp fest of people drinking sex juices. And then they drank it, and then they felt like they flew or something, which is the biggest bunch of wrongness. I mean, really, if it was that easy. Slurp down some sex juice, and then you're done, it's no problem. Most ridiculous books, but when they publish books like that, and they get awards in academia, I did great research. Because the sort of Western contempt for the great Indian yogi and scientists is so huge that they would imagine that these siddhas were running around looking for pussy. And that was it. Some really suppressed monks suddenly jumped out of their monasteries and ran out. Right? I mean, it's ridiculous.
Explains
everything. Huh?
Yeah, that explains everything.
Anyway, I gave a speech like that to some of the people who are friends of those writers in Norway, and they didn't burn me at the stake. Actually, they were persuaded. What?
So you're saying that it's more of the ovulation fluid?
And yeah, whatever that is.
When she's, that's usually, when the woman's most ecstatic and most fertile, and then there's often at the exact time of ovulation some blood that comes with it too.
Yeah.
So that's much more, makes a lot more sense to me than just the straight.
Yeah, they go on saying blood, and then they think, well, I better say menstrual blood. Then they go menstrual blood, and they think everybody's trying to slurp down the menstrual blood. I mean, give me a break. Sure, there might be something interesting about that, but you know, because they're overcoming all kinds of taboos. But that's not going to make you fly. And you've heard such nonsense. You know? And that's actually, guy has tenure and sits him right. All those taulas, that's what the kula is, and the taulas and that. And that's, oh, they're out there. I mean, really, I don't want to, girl, that's so silly. But I finally got that to them at the International Association of Tibetan Studies.
Ovum, good translation.
Yes, I got it. Anyway, so then I thought you'd find this interesting. This is nice medical one. And the medical one tends to be a little bit, you see the red and the white and then the looping. But they don't show like the six-fold loop and all this thing at the heart center. And the unraveling at the heart center is really, you see, you got into the other day, you started going off into trance about the heart. And that is, Tsongkhapa makes that total point all the time. You know, that a lot of yogis and a lot of people interpret the Tantra that the way of entering the central channel is, you know, after you've done a lot of things and you loosen up the knots, you know, is to go in and because it's related to orgasm, so you go in through the center of the the genital chakra. Go back in and orgasm internally in the petals of the different chakras, since we orgasm all the way chakra by chakra, you know. And that's all great. Buddha, he says, that's all good stuff. No problem. It's a big deal, and it's great. But the ultimate thing is not when it goes there or when it goes in the brain. The ultimate thing is when it happens in the heart. And where you can open completely the heart chakra, which everybody has done that millions of times, according to them, according to their science. Every time you have died in all of your previous lives, you completely open your central channel. When you open the heart chakra, it's when that your subtle body mind leaves town, takes off. And that's why they do that thing where they try to make it go up, because that's a little, goes into a better direction if it goes up than down. But the highest siddha yogi is who opens that and then can stay, keep it there, or can leave the body suspended in clear light, infinite energy, in what they call from outside a cataleptic trance, you know, where they're not even breathing, actually, but somehow the oxygen is getting to where it needs to go enough to maintain life, like hibernating, you know, like life support, you know. And then from that central place, they leave and they go into this what's called the magic body, which is like a bardo body. And then they go around and do things and accumulate merit and cleanse the deep unconscious and purify the super soul, the DNA of the soul type of thing. Really, really, really exalted far out thing. And what my proof in Norway to those people was, one of them, is that in order to do that, if you have a partner who's just someone off the street, who doesn't know anything and just is into having ordinary sexuality, for whatever reason, either coerced or hired or, you know, whatever it might be, you know, then they're not going to want to sit still and have orgasms up inside their central channel, because their central channel isn't open. So they're going to start the normal huffing and puffing routine that we don't know about. And then this person is going to be just, you know, not able to do their trip, you know what I'm saying, opening heart chakra and all this complex thing, when actually they're going to abandon the coarse body. Then further one, I get nailed and more. I'm sorry, I'm telling you, but you're yogis. The further one that really surprised them, it surprised me when I started thinking about it, is something called the nine mergers for a yogi who begins to have opened the channel and start to do these magic body things. And one of them has to do with coming back and merging the magic body back into their own central channel, and coming back into their previous coarse body as a yogi, as an ordinary human, and as to be a siddha, you know, to help people in their society, you know, which is not necessarily something that they feel like doing because they're in a more blissful subtle body condition. But there's a yoga, one of the mergers is where you come back and you merge the emanation body that you've been experimenting with, the Buddha body, the Sambhoga body of a Buddha, and the Dharma, the reality body of a Buddha, and you merge them back into your, you know, sleep state, dream state, waking state, come back and be yourself. But when you do that, this is an interesting mechanism. We were talking about this, about rebirth. When you do that, you see yourself and your consort, your former body and your consort, as parents, as a set of parents. And then you go down and you enter your own mouth or crown. You know, because you're coming like a bardo, you're like a bardo being in the magic body. You know, like, but you're in a great samaja body or a kalachakra body or whatever, which you learn to do for long, massive periods of mental stabilization, where you really can re-envision yourself and suddenly feel your shoulder having three arms on each side, or 24 or 12 on each side, whatever it is. And you come back in, you leave that, you melt into the clear light, and then you come back in into your own mouth, crown, down through your own central channel, into the womb of the consort, and then at that point, coming from the consort, you then re-enter your own heart chakra somehow. I mean, I don't quite know how that part works, where the link is, not sure, but you're in this complete embrace with that consort. So in other words, they become your mother and father, because you may not know that, those of you who haven't read the Tibetan misnamed Book of the Dead, which is actually called the Book of Natural Liberation in the Between State. It has nothing to do with any dead. But the mechanism of taking rebirth is where you are attracted to your parents. you have a primal scene with your parents before conception. You know what primal scene is? The psychologists know that, right? You don't know the primal scene? Oh, primal scene. Freud had all these poor women in these different sales islands who were freaking out, and then he got back with them to the primal scene, which was where they wandered in little like, you know, Isabella or something, wandered into the bedroom where mom and dad were into huffing and puffing. And then she's freaking out, you know. And then he said, because she wants to... But he didn't know about this. It was already thousands of years, India and Tibet, they were aware of this kind of a thing. And instead of freaking out and running out and getting hysterical and being treated by Mr. Freud, instead you get conceived because you get into like a gangbang with your parents. Sorry, to put it archly. And if you're going to be female, you really like dad. And you're kind of mom, it's like, you know, you move over, honey. And if you're going to be male, you like mom. And dad, you could take a hike. But then what happens is you pass out. And somehow, you know, someone pointed out, well, what if mom and dad don't even have really good sex? Well, you find it in their self, they have good sex, even though they personally maybe have like some dysfunction. Their cells are blissfully attracted to each other, and so they're sort of open. They're in that open, near the clear light space. And naturally, therefore, they get an immigrant. The boundary is down for immigrants. And the migrant arrives. You know? So we're all migrants in that sense. So that's already there in the popular culture, in some sectors of India and in Tibet universally, by this time, by the time Buddhism has become permeated Indian, you know, Tibetan culture from India. But so then this is sort of that on the highest level, consciously doing all of that. You know, the idea. Now, as I said, I say to them, this might be one like fantabulous delusion. And it may be totally impossible, all this. And the materialists may be right. Maybe we're just really nothing and it's just something they really worked themselves into a frenzy over in India and Tibet. But to me, it makes really good sense. The more I study it, the more amazing it is that people had these abilities. And as like scientists, astronauts, that's what I call them, psychonauts. They really, really did this stuff. And this is the way the world works, I believe. And it's really neat, actually, I think. Really cool. And yogis, so yogis, what are you guys doing? You know, you are, you know beyond... beyond just, you know, being healthy and being positive and being happy and, you know, releasing your inner organs and your heart and your energies and avoiding arthritis and many things that you're doing, you are also in the tradition of this thing where you are seeing your own body as a vehicle of holy happiness and deep inner bliss. And to satisfy yourself in life, without having to, like, you know, go bankrupt and kill all your suppliers and become Donald Trump and a billionaire, you're going to be blissful without grabbing all these things that are not going to really... I don't think Donald Trump has fun. Not really. He likes shout and scream, but he's terrible. Look at his face. You know? He doesn't feel that. He has the emotional plague, what Wilhelm Reich called. The only Western psychologist who really got close to this deep... inner energy level that these people have discovered and that you are working on with your great teacher on this is Wilhelm Reich. If anybody that never heard of him or doesn't know who that is, I advise you to take a look at it. And he has this great expression called the emotional plague, which afflicts any society that he knew, which were Western societies, but actually does afflict Asian ones as well. And it has to do with a kind of desensitization of the human being and an infliction of a culture through posture, actually, and structure of the way the body is held. And he gives a brilliant analysis of the militaristic posture, where the chin is jammed down in the throat, and the stomach is sucked in to imprison the diaphragm, where you won't feel inner fear or any kind of sensitivity or screaming. The pelvis is retracted, so your butt is sticking out, right, like this, you know, and pelvis drawn back. And so basically you're meant to be made by posture unfeeling as possible. And therefore, you become a very frustrated being, and you can't feel your inner, what he called streaming, your inner orgone energy, which means just natural energy, natural bliss energy. You can't feel it. And he had blue light. It was had a blue color. He somehow discovered. But now he never heard of it. Well, they said in Germany in 1910 when they heard a little of yoga, but very little. They didn't know much. And he said, and then people who are not in the military, but they all have this kind of thing. You know, women were put in these terrible corsets, you know, in Europe. Because Europe was highly militaristic, you know, most militaristic part of Eurasia, probably. You know, and they were, what did they, you know, the servants would put their foot on their back and pull this thing, it was a crunch in the and thing. And, you know, ballet, which they think is so great. But you know what ballet was? Louis XIV thought that women should have a chance to prance around like the fencers, you know, killing each other with swords, but he didn't think it was appropriate to stick them in the breast with the épée. So he had them do ballet like it was just it was a knockoff from fencing. Did you know that? I asked. So they're doing it like this because they can't fence and savaging their toes. Of course, they can make something beautiful out of anything, and they do. I'm not totally against it, but I don't like it because I get involved in the pain of their lower legs when I go to. I can't help myself. You can bring, have a foot rub. So I can't enjoy too much. Anyway, so this is that. This is the kind of scientific thing. And this is the schema here. You see, coarse body mind, elemental flesh and blood. That's the meat space stuff. And the six senses are the coarse mind. You know, the six consciousnesses, mental consciousness and the five sense consciousnesses. Then the subtle body mind is the neural channels, you know, nadi, vayu, and bindu. You know, the neural channels, energies, and neurotransmitters. And of course, that female ovum, as I call it, is a bindu. You know, it's not an ordinary blood, it's a red bindu. And actually, they call it bodhicitta, bodhisattva mind, bodhisattva spirit. They actually align it with the red and white bodhisattva spirit, they call it. And why do they do that? Because what is the bodhisattva spirit? Bodhisattva spirit is spirit of love and compassion for all beings. Okay? So those subtle hormones or whatever they are, neurotransmitters, you know, is sperm a neurotransmitter? No, I don't know what it is. But those things, when they activate and they get into the center of the nervous system, people melt. It's a time when people melt down. And when they melt, they get close to the infinity of energy that's available for all living things. And that infinity of energy, being an infinity of energy, it has the ability to satisfy whatever need any living thing actually has. Instead of this little piece of dung that the dung beetle wants to eat. Instead of eating some dung and then being hungry and go and find some more dung, it just floats into clear light and every appetite is satisfied. And so that's when beings melt. And at that boundary of the melting is where then, of course, the migrants arrive. People who want to join in the happy party. It's a family. And then the people are there, and the mother and father are not capable in that kind of moment of thinking, this will cost me $260,000 in Harvard. I don't think I can manage this. At that moment, they might think that later. So anyway, whatever it is, that I call it neurotransmitter at this moment. And then that's the body. It's your. So actually, I love it because that's like, remember in Don Gennaro and Don Juan in Castaneda, they called he saw them as a balls of luminous fibers. Remember that? So he saw their subtle body, that particular subtle body mind, their network of nadis filled with bliss energies. They're the luminous fibers. You know? Remember he saw them like them. I don't think he could have made that up, Castaneda. I think those guys really do that. And then the subtle mind are these three states called, which I call luminance, radiance, aloka, abhasa, and upalabdhi. Actually, well, aloka, aloka, abhasa, aloka, upalabdhi, these are called. So these are the luminance, radiance, immanence, intuitions. And they are, if you're more conscious of your instincts, and this one has 33 desire-related instincts in it. And this has 40 aggression-related instincts in it. This is solar, this is lunar, and this has seven ignorance-related, you know, stupefaction, unconsciousness-related instincts. And the normal person, when they die, they go through those three states, a moonlit space, a sunlit space, a darklit space, and then, but they are surging with the instincts are taking over, they're swimming in those instincts. And then they're having like nightmares or sometimes, pleasant things, but they're very unstably swooshing around with them. And then they go unconscious in this one, in the immanence level, and then they don't recognize the clear light when they hit it, because the clear light is like a split second of infinite expansion. But they're so desperate to be a boundary and to be able to fend off what they fear in the universe that they just rush right through that and seek for another way of being boundaried and being a person like taking care of themselves in an environment. You know what I mean? So then that's when you hit the super subtle body mind, which is the super subtle physical energies, which are kind of pranas, but a super subtle type of prana. And sort of right on the edge because it's this infinite thing, it's impossible to describe, even they even say it. And then clear light, bliss void mind. And that's a major reason that all this was esoteric in Buddhist history, because that super subtle body mind would have been attached to someone, and that's my fixed and permanent self. That little thing, you know. And I'm thinking that's a little thing, that's their core thing, you know. Rather than knowing that that's like everything. At the same time, it's beyond all dualities of that type. Okay? You got that? And then I have a list of the different things. But never mind. And this is where Buddha taught Tantra as a Theravada. Because these are the four, I mentioned this the other day, these are the eight states, well, the eight states of meditative trance states, or, you know, absorption states, people like to say. I don't like that word, but I prefer trance. You know, which are, these are the former realm, and this is Brahma's realm here, equanimity level. And all of the lower states are, the higher state encompasses all the lower states, even though they seem to be separate. But the lower states have not yet reached the higher states. Down here is where we are, normally, along with all other kinds of beings, including the gods of the desire realm. But these eight states are exactly the same. If you turn it upside down, I do have a slide like that, but I don't know quite where it is. Then this is like earth, water, fire, wind. And here's where you go beyond hardness, beyond solidity, beyond mass. And this is just space, consciousness, nothingness, and then there's Turiya, that's the fourth state. And none of them are nirvana, but this one is very close to a clear light of the world. And we talked about that the other day. Okay, that's enough for me, I think. Yes.
What?
Just to make it down to earth, you know, when you do this, if I could just supplement the breathing thing, if you visualize yourself as having a blue channel down the center, and you, usually when you do it as an initial practice, you have it at that point that Richard points to so artistically, like that, you know, it's like four fingers below the navel, right? The hara kind of level. Pelvic floor, etc., right? Mula Bandha, whatever. And you go there, and then you think, like plumbing pipes, and you think that the red one on the right, going from the right nostril, goes down there, and down there, and it's like one of those long, skinny balloons that Jeff Koons makes a fortune by tying into dogs. And you know those kind of balloons?
Yep.
And you sort of think of it as having it linked around the center, but the kinks pop out, and it becomes like a balloon. And then, like a plumbing pipe, it fits into the one on the left, if you do the right one first, it fits into the one on the left, which is white. It's red, and it fits into the red one. And then, so when you breathe in, blocking this nostril into this one, and then it goes down there, and then you hold it for a minute, and you let it sort of pop out the kinks in the balloon, you know? You think, you visualize it's doing that, and free the central channel, the blue one. And then when you blow out the right, left nostril, you feel it's coming up through the white one, and it's knocking the kinks out of the white one, and then you do it the other way, where you put the white one, and you hold it, and then you push it back up the left one. You do that three times on each side, or either alternating, or three at one, three at the other, and then you change the plumbing at the bottom, and you take the white one, the red one, and the white one, and you loop them around like a plumbing juncture, where they go into the bottom of the central one, which you then imagine just being at the navel place there. You don't get involved in the genitalia, the secret place. You just put it into the central channel. So then when you breathe in both, it goes in and out, in and down the right one. You hold it for a sec while they kind of loosen up. And then when you exhale, you visualize that it's coming up the central channel and then comes out, but comes out either through the nostrils or the mouth, because it's cleared up the energy of the central channel. And you do that three times, right? So that's really nice to combine them, if you do that visualization. It's considered auspicious. It isn't that when you visualize removing the threefold knot, you're going to have immediately an internal orgasm, and you're going to die, because you actually can't unloosen that knot that fast or easily. But by imagining it, it establishes a subliminal basic template or somehow you eventually to do that as a yogi. Yeah. So it's nice to do even as a beginner. Is that all right? I'm sorry, I don't mean to really get into your province there. But it's kind of fun, isn't it? Well, that's a yogi. Hey, I'm not a yogi. Here you are.
But I think like when you visualize like knots being on,
you're
kind of almost feeling, you get like a little teeny taste of it.
I think so, yeah.
And then you have to go out and kind of make peace with the world. Because all those little blockages have to do with usually others, other beings.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that you've got some unfinished business with, you know, that you might.
That certainly must be the case. But also, so, it's from our culture and everything, too.
Oh, yeah, from the culture. And so you have to, like, work from inside and outside. To get the knots out.
That's good, going back to yama and niyama.
Yeah, inside, outside. And then sometimes if you concentrate, you know, just use a lot of this chakra vedana, you know, piercing the chakra.
Yes.
Nadi shodana, blowing up.
Yeah.
Then if you haven't really, don't have the background for that, then you can go nuts.
Definitely. I've met a few.
Just because of the nature of your environment. And
yes.
You still don't, you know, you still can't see your environment or
yes.
How beautiful it actually is.
Yes.
And it's like, and you're too sensitive.
Yes.
You know, and your sensitivity gets to you.
Yes. Internally also there's a thing that the Tibetan medicine calls soglum, which means sok is prana, you know. And lung is vayu, and it means, but in the medical sense, it means where, for some reason, which yogi, it can happen to yogis, where they get into dealing with the heart chakra thing, which is very well known in Tibetan culture, sort of broad level people who are not necessarily that good at yoga. But for some reason, they sort of put a lot of pressure on, like, forcefully, like removing knots or something like that. You know? And then what can happen is that there can be sort of neural bubbles in the ganglion, where the knot is there, but then there's some kind of bubble there. And then that bubble can be really cause a lot of looniness. It can cause psychosis and things. And it's really a problem. And also pain. People can get like shooting pains and things. And they say when one gets that pain, that one has to focus on the heart chakra as this super, super subtle mind, clear light of bliss in the heart chakra, that deepest soul place, and realize that that is a gateway to infinity. And then think of a light ray coming from that in the form of a hook, like a tractor beam, like Star Trek tractor beam, and pulling back that pain, or pulling it back that bubble, pulling the prana out of that place, back into where then it can go, it can be completely released in the center of the chakra. It's a nice thing they talk about as a way of doing it when you have this kind of a pain. I can't really do it, but it's, I think it's really a nice thing.
The Hatha Yoga certificate says also you have to have a guru.
I'm John, what?
The Hatha
Yes, yes. Well, it's good to have a guru to do that. Yeah. But you have to do it yourself. So the guru opens the door for you. And also, there's the issue of morphic resonance. It's a big issue of morphic resonance. What you really need from a guru is morphic resonance, which is just symbolized in a ritual. But the resonance, in other words, if the guru themselves has some sort of an open point in the chakra, Baba, native Baba, like fall to the marma, you know, to the marma, but I can't think. Is it always marma vedana? Is it veda? Penetrate? Might be. Penetrate the marma. Marma meaning this sort of vital point, right? So if a guru has their vital point open, then being in the field of the guru, your vital point tends to sort of slip a little loose. That's why some people get annoyed immediately they meet gurus sometimes, some kind of people. The field of the guru is a big deal. And for example, there's a wonderful thing in the ethics, actually. A wonderful thing. In the beginning of the Theravada Vinaya, the ethical thing, the monk, there's a story of a Brahmin who comes to see the Buddha against the advice of the other Brahmins, who say, don't go see that Gautama. He's like some upstart. He's like, he doesn't follow things, and he's like, whatever, you know. I said, no, I hear he's a really great guy. I want to go and talk to him. So then he goes to see him, and then Buddha was welcome, and then he sits down next to Buddha, and he says, I heard you were really kind of cool, like wise man, really great, but, you didn't stand up when I came here, and I'm older than you, and I'm a Brahmin. And so I guess you just don't have any taste. And then the Buddha says, yeah, you're right, I don't have any taste. I lost my taste for pleasant sounds, pleasant sights, pleasant pleasant food, pleasant taste, pleasant touch. So in a sense, it's true, you're speaking of me, you could say I have no taste. The guy says, oh, I get that, but you have no ethics, You have no etiquette, you have no manner. One after another, he keeps insulting the Buddha. Because the Buddha didn't get up when he came and just said, welcome, have a seat. And this really afflicted this Brahmin, and he can't deal with this, with what happened, But he's sort of held because he wanted to see the Buddha, and he has a feeling maybe he's a good person, but now he keeps saying, you have no brain, no manners, no this and that. The Buddha keeps agreeing, but then explains it in terms of that he's in another world. And then finally, the guy says, Oh, I get it. And then he says, it's like the chicken and the egg. He says, there's several chicks and eggs in the nest. And then one chick bounds on the shell and breaks it and gets out. And then another chicken is still in there, a little chicken, and it doesn't get out yet. And then it does get out. But which one is older? Oh, the one who breaks the egg. Oh, yeah, well, I broke the egg, for instance. You didn't break it yet. So I say, I'm older. And then he starts, and then the guy gets a little bit convinced and says, well, what is it that you do? I mean, what's hard? The guy now he's kind of can cope with his disorientation. And then the Buddha gives this beautiful thing of all the levels of samadhi, all the ethics and all the good behavior and all the well-being and all the niceness around in society. And then finally, right after nirvana, he goes, it's the most marvelous passage, But it shows this, and then he uses that Vedic thing that's in the Vedas, actually. At one point he says, so-and-so, elder so-and-so, the thing is, I could feel that you wanted me to get up, he said. And I would have gotten up, but if a Buddha would get up, in the case of a person, then that person's head would split in seven pieces, which is a Vedic expression for someone who has some kind of a falling out, or can't make an argument or something, get something really wrong. Their head splits in seven pieces, meaning that you would feel, from what your question was, you would feel the morphic resonance of someone with this total open chakra, it's like a streaming flood of bliss person. And you would feel that, and you just feel so disoriented and threatened, and you'd think, what is happening to me? I'm fainting, and you'd have a fit. Because that's, Wilhelm Reich brilliantly puts it. He says that Christ is murdered, or siddhas are persecuted because when armored people who carry the emotional plague of insensitivity, because they're not open to their own inner sensations, they're frightened of them, when they are in the field of a person with those kind of energies, streaming energies, he called it, they start to feel them in themselves. And then that frightens them. They feel they're going to lose control, you know, they're going to pee in their pants, they're going to go berserk, they're going to go crazy, whatever it is they feel. And so they rush to shut it off, the source of this threat, which is that energy in that other person. So they want to kill the siddha, or they want to kill the saint, or kill the, you know, the son of God, or whatever he is, son of man, or whatever he was. You know. It's really interesting. Isn't it? So it shows that right in the Vinaya. So in a way, therefore, they have this thing like, why isn't there a full Buddha running around? Why isn't there one in Times Square with the egg and everything, like an E.T. kind of character, like red fingers and light with a big egg on top of his head and floating around, you know, doing miracles? Why isn't it? Because if that streaming field was open with the Trump followers, which according to Senator Bill Bradley are about 20%, 18 to 20% of the American electorate, they would be so freaked out by that energy, they'd like start doing mass shootings, and, you know, you'd have riots, it would be crazy. So there's a kind of thing about how much do you release, there's a connectedness to the outsiders, which you rightly pointed out about. Right? From the inner to the outer. But that's on the other hand, that's a very encouraging thing, because that means if you do intense meditating yourselves, and you know, someone telling you, why are you meditating all the time? You could be helping me planting the peas in the garden, or you could be washing the dishes, or whatever it is. And you could, and you should, of course. But when you have a breakthrough in your mind, this resonates immediately to other people. And, you know, your heart feels a little better, and then there, when they meet you, then they feel a little lift in their heart. And without you doing anything or saying anything, they certainly don't hear say, hey, how's the heart lifting? My heart feels so great. They'll be mad. But if it's just your own, in other words, what you're doing internally is affecting the world right away before you've done anything else. Right? So that's why you could do a retreat or something without feeling bad at all.
I think like the culture of, you know, the monks, monasteries, the etiquette amongst sadhus is that they generally present themselves as beggars and servants,
right,
rather than as, oh, I'm a master, you know,
right,
kiss my, you know.
I know. Cases they do the other, though.
Yeah.
You know the Naropa story. Naropa was into like whatever, and he had his consort, and he were into it, and somehow they couldn't get uncoupled. But they were hungry. So he was out with a bow and arrow, and she was still wrapped around him in Benares, and he was out hunting the royal deer that was sacred. And then he cooked one, and they were having a barbecue, still wrapped around him. And then the people were like, this won't do. And they said, what's the matter? Look, I just had it. And then he makes the deer come back to life, and it runs off. She said, well, I didn't kill anything. He said, oh, what are you doing? No. And then they put them on a big pyre, burn them at the stake. And they do. They light it. And then the next morning they come back and there's a big lotus and they're still at it. It's a little more Indian than the cross one. But it's like they're more focused on the resurrection. Sorry, guys. It is Independence Day. It was around a little bit. I rip that is the story of Narayana. Normally they're very low key. The siddha types. They're like anthropologists, the siddhas. Yeah. They go out with the tribals and they deal with people who.
They try to fit in, you know, so that they can.
Yeah.
You
know. Yes. There are a few siddhas. What?
I think
yes, John.
Was Lucas trying to point out like the Advaita Vedanta point of view where there's the force?
Yes.
Is neither a positive thing. That we tend to attribute God as this positive sort of thing. Like in the Uvashishta, he goes through this great diatribe of how
yes.
how you know, Brahman is not positive. Like
Well, you're saying the force is not positive?
Yeah, it's not a positive nor a negative.
Well, I don't know. I think that there's a saying like that, but I don't completely, I think it's more complex than that. It's like enlightenment, okay, itself. We think that, when is it that we feel relief in our normal life, other than when we have some yogic moment of attainment? But otherwise, when is it that we feel relief? When we're unconscious and asleep, right? So, yes, when you definitely feel relief when you sleep and you're unconscious, you're happy as a bee. Come on. You're happy. If you have a bad dream and wake up, then you're unhappy. Right? You're definitely happy. And so we naturally assume that enlightenment is going to be some sort of collapse of consciousness in some fixed state where we won't be bothered. There's a tendency to project that's what enlightenment is. But if enlightenment actually is being present infinitely in everything, and seeing beings suffering, feeling and being one with them, and being empathetic with them, and yet not being sucked into their suffering, but seeing them simultaneously in a double vision, where you see them as made of bliss, as drops in an ocean of bliss, and they are managing to suffer anyway. And so your job is, you know, joining the job of all Buddhas, all enlightened beings, and trying to help them find their own nature, which is bliss. So that's a complicated consciousness. It's a it's maintaining kind of a cognitive dissonance to such an extreme degree it's almost inconceivable to us. You know, but rather than something, and so the beyond good and evil thing is like people who want to sort of drop out and say, well, it's all the same. Really, evil is other people suffering, but it's not. Never mind. But the point is infinite energy. If that's the deepest layer of the universe, rather than nothingness, if clear light of the void is such that another is the deepest layer, then it doesn't tolerate unhappiness. So therefore, it won't tolerate, it considers people suffering to be evil. And it doesn't think that, but it just automatically flows into whatever the deficit is that causes the suffering. It automatically does. Its problem with, if a being has like a notion of its boundary, it's not going to be open to receiving that grace, you know, that bliss, that sustenance. So In fact, if it comes on too powerfully, it's going to make it more uptight. It's like rushing up to give a hug to a paranoiac. They think you're like, you know, going to give them a body slam, you know, and they fight you off. You know, so I think the Buddhists would say that the Vajra is Samantabhadra. You know, is all around goodness. That's the vision they have. Maybe they're deluded, and. Beyond good and evil, they don't do it. Sometimes they will say...
But that's just in relative.
What?
That's relative terms, right?
What? Well, all terms are relative. Right. All terms are relative. Right. But relatively speaking, I mean, it is a bit... Buddha's good news. I mean, Buddha was a happy camper, don't you think? Didn't he look happy? How could he be happy with people having holocausts? Unless he's like some kind of moron. He's happy because... Finally, the goodness is there, and the insanity and the torture and the mutual destruction and the self-destruction finally wears itself out, and there's this infinite energy to supplement the deficit. So the Vajra becomes a symbol, instead of a symbol of a weapon of Indra, a weapon of an authoritarian king of the gods, the Vajra becomes a symbol of the infinite energy of the clear light of the void, which means love. Pure love. Not a person, just impersonal love. If love is the wish to, as it's defined, not sexual love necessarily, but love maitri, the love of a friend, the love of a mother, if it's defined as the will to the happiness of what you're loving, beloved, then that means it's pure will to satisfaction of every being in its field, and since its field is infinite, and has infinite energy, no lack of resource, you have to call it love, in relative terms. You know, hate is just fire, you know. I think, really. But it makes people sick, you know, if they overdo it. You can hate hate, actually. That's the only thing worthy of hate. It's hate. You hate hate.
Worthy of.
Yes. I'm sorry?
You know, this Krodha.
Yeah, Krodha, yeah. But that's why I never call it wrathful. I think that's a really bad translation. Peaceful and wrathful deities, I never do it. They're mild and fierce deities, or gentle and fierce deities. Fierce deities. Like a mother, like your mom, when John Bultmann Jr. was rushing over with a joyous look on his face to stick his finger in the electric socket, your mom went, "Don't do that!"
Yeah.
In a fierce manner. She was not angry with you, but she scared you. And you went, "Ooh!" And then you developed a complex about an electric socket. Years later.
Still working
on it. Right? So that's fit there, those Krodhas. The Krodha, there's a big Krodha right here. That's the all good Herukan, you know, who is trying to help you at a place when you reach a place in the Bardo where you are filled with fear and you're perceiving all kind of monsters coming at you and frightened. And they're showing, they're sort of being your protector, coming fiercer than anything that's terrifying. You know? But before you go there, these are the mild ones, the gentle ones over there, who are, you know, offering you sort of beauty and relaxed, you know, and love in a sort of obvious way. But these are just as loving. So they're not wrathful.
Bob, can I ask you a question about pranayama in different Buddhist traditions?
I don't think it's different.
Oh, no.
I think it's different. Different people don't know what to do. That.
So here's what I was going to ask. I live in Thailand.
No, you're not was going to. You are asking.
Right. I live in Thailand, and I don't really... It doesn't... Pranayama doesn't seem to be a part of the Buddhist tradition.
Of course it is. Well, you can. It's one of the six branches of, you know, of the perfection stages. Pranayama. Pratyahara. Pranayama. Dharana. Anusmriti, Samadhi, and there's another one that I forgot.
So something like alternate nostril breathing. Is
what?
That something like you were showing Nadi Shodhana, that's alternate nostril
yes.
breathing? Is that a technique that is used equally in
sure.
different Buddhist traditions?
Sure.
Okay.
But those are considered, you know, yogis, advanced things. You know? Mm-hmm. You know, remember that all of the Asian traditions until recently were in cultures that were largely agricultural, but they had big cities where their people were learning, and in those cities they learned, but the masses of people, like even still in India today, are still, what, 90% is still in villages.
Still not.
Right? And so you didn't have necessarily that many yogis in those, unless they came back from the university, Takshashila or Nalanda or somewhere, and then went to their Geburtsdorf, you know, their birth village, and were the local yogi there, and then people like that in the village, but so it was not this, you know, it's not like today when we either are doomed as a species on this planet, it's soon, or it's like Dharma everywhere, yoga everywhere, on TV, on Facebook, you know, Buddha on Facebook, Mahayogis on Facebook, it's like unprecedented. You know, and Kali Yuga Wallahs don't like it. They are more into the doom thing. But the Shambhala Wallahs think that's where we are, close to. You know, where so many people are going to be like aware of this and that. But it's amazing. It really is considered. What?
It's happened.
It has happened. Yeah, it's happened. But there's some places shut off to it, and that's where all this violence and terrible stuff is going on. And that also one of the key factors of that, of course, is the women. You know, if enlightenment is not defined as some guy shooting off into outer space where he wouldn't have to wash the dishes ever, right, or be reborn as anything, then just like hanging with Brahma, meaning waiting for, you know, either having permanent food of samadhi or waiting for dinner, you know, like the Brahman does, you know. From those ladies come scuttling out of the smoky kitchen in the back, drink. And if that's not enlightenment, actually, that's some kind of ultimate narcissistic samadhi. And enlightenment is actually fusion with all life, all beings, and super interconnection, the absolute Brahman as everywhere, everything, eye in the eye, ear in the ear, nose in the nose, hand in the dishwashing pot. also, they didn't mention, but that too. And if that's the case, then actually the women are more advanced than the men because toward it, as humans, because they have the visceral experience of the crossing the boundary between self and other, differently than, you know, much more viscerally. Viscerally is the word for it. Which man is going to have a migrant in their belly for 9 months without complaining overly? Which male is going to do that? I'd like to know. And then have labor pains? Even being in the room, you want to have a spinal block or incident. Yes. Talk about more president. So that's a different thing. That's more complicated. Even enlightenment remains totally interconnected. They go on and on, but oh yeah, Buddha's free of the samsara. Yeah, sure. Sure. But actually, no. Until everyone else is not free. Even. They don't want to say it like that. It sounds rude. Poor guy. I mean, they say it. A Buddha is defined. You can read any of his books. As a mother, he perceives every sentient being as a mother perceives her only beloved child. What a nightmare. Donald Trump, my baby. Hitler. Oh. Some venomous serpent or some horrible tick. Bringing U.S. government certified germ warfare Lyme disease. Sorry. Happy 4th of July.
Interdependence Day.
What's that?
Interdependence Day.
If only. It should be. It will be.
Yeah.
It will be. But I still want, I really, I don't know if the guy gave my, I sent a memo to Angela Merkel a few weeks ago. And someone said they were going to deliver it, but I, maybe she ignored it. Maybe I never got to it. You know, they have to do something different about all these people from Syria, you know, from that disaster there. They really do. They can't absorb them all and put them in Birkenau again, you know what I mean? Which they will end up doing if they have a million of them, until they learn German.
Big camps, yeah.
Yeah, that's no good. They're separated from their families. They should make a new city in Turkey, a new city across the border from the asinine thing. In Lebanon,
in Kurdistan,
in Jordan, yeah, or in Kurdistan, if the Kurds will allow it, certainly. They should make Kurdistan. They could take Erdogan and send him here to Menla for a few weeks. Erdogan, you know, he's only attacking the Kurds again because they wouldn't vote for him as permanent president. You know that. It had nothing to do with anything they did. They were all big nice. So. Send Donald Trump to Syria to make a deal. See how it worked out. What?
Yeah, send it to Aleppo.
Actually, he could have made a deal if he'd done it sooner. I know the solution for Syria, totally. The Alawites own the beachfront. That's where they all live. Coming down on that eastern part of the Mediterranean, they have like 400 miles of beachfront. Give them hotels.
Trump hotels.
Assad hotels. Assad. Put them there and then let the Sunni Syrians have their way there with the big majority and then defend that border. They'd be happy. They'd be billionaires. And they wouldn't bother with it. Go to the Alawite casino. Send money to your Tehran, to the Ayatollah. Bring the Ayatollah over for a massage. Get his streaming spine a little bit. And Mrs. Ayatollah, give her a break. I'm sorry, it must be time.
Oh, yeah.
I used up all the time, which is annoying.
Oh, no.
I was so lazy today, too. I don't know why.
Oh, yeah.
That's the happiest guy lives in Bali. Do you realize that? What an awesome thing to live in Bali. So smart. It's an amazing place. Did you, I brought my Bali bell so you could see it. Have you ever seen it?
Yeah.
See, this is a, the Shaivite priests have this bell. This is a vajra. And actually, it's a fierce vajra because the prongs don't close. They're the prongs that they curl, but they don't close. So that's that. That means that's a like fierce energy, you know. And they, but they don't have the other complementary vajra, you know, for this hand. In tantra, you're supposed to have your vajra and bell, and keep it with you always, because your vajra is your magic body of love and compassion for all beings, which is the, which is your rehearsal for having an emanation body. When John Bultmann becomes John Bultmann Buddha, then you're going to emanate everywhere in the universe to help beings. So your emanation body symbol that you will have is your vajra. And the bell is your female side, your interconnectedness with everything, prajna, you know, transcendent wisdom. And when you put them down, you always put them this way, so you have to cross your hands to pick them up, symbolizing the union of wisdom and compassion.
But doesn't that depend on which...
What's that?
That depends on which tantra you're looking at, right?
No, all of them. No. Not in Buddhist tantra. I mean, maybe
this is
in...
What?
What? What's that?
This is what His Holiness was teaching in Hunser.
He was teaching that what? That you
that
take...
The wisdom and compassion were switched.
He was teaching in which context? In what context?
What's
our topic? What? No, wait. Say what?
That, I mean, my normal understanding was that, yeah, like you said, that there has always been this outside.
Right. Is that the right side? You just hold in the right hand.
Sure, yeah.
And you cross them so that that symbolizes their union.
But the wisdom and compassion were switched. But maybe that just probably misunderstood.
So the vajra is wisdom and the bell is compassion? Well, I'm sure somebody followed that, you know. All teachings about relative reality are only relative. They're not absolute doctrines. Right? You know, they switch male and female.
Yeah, right.
You can practice Vajra Yoga here, where John Bogman can visualize yourself concretely having a female body. And the female can visualize themselves as Vajra Dara or something having a male body. And then when they do that, and that can be fun, I guess.
Well, that's our only option, though. With, like,
what's what?
With Kala Chakra, it's the only option, really, for the woman to visualize herself as Kala Chakra.
Yes, yeah? that's possible.
But isn't that the only thing that, isn't that what you've said, that we do have to visualize ourselves as Kala Chakra, not the other way around?
In the main practice, because, of course, the main practice is oriented the way, because of Buddhism existing in chauvinist cultures, most practitioners have been male in the past. I think that's changing now on the planet, but in that sense, that's the initial option. But there will be, like Kala Chakra has this one thing I think I mentioned the other day, the speech mandala. The deities in the speech mandala, the females are the dominant one of the couple, and the male's the little guy, you know, little yaksha guy.
I love that.
The little yaksha, and the females are the big sort of macho thing, and. So there's, and also the colors are different. The couples are not the same color, like the black male is, unites with the yellow female and vice versa and so on. And also in the mind mandala, each being has two bodies. So they have one body in one way and one body in another way. So it's endlessly complicated, and I'm certain, I don't know of it for sure, but I'm certain there's a way where you can be, there must be a sadhana of just Vishwamata. So just like you have Ekavira thing, where you have an all-male sadhana, where your body is only the male body without a consort, but they call Ekavira, I call it the Lone Ranger form. So there is the Vajra Yogini in the Chakrasambhara, it's just a female, and there's no male, and she's a still complete Buddha, just herself. And that males will meditate also. So there's every, there's every option. As I think I said the other day, there was the one guy who couldn't break through in Kapasambara and until his guru came and told him to visualize his own head as a donkey head. And then he finally reached whatever it was he was trying to reach, whatever stage. But that's a human phase. There's four phases. He somehow was stuck. Couldn't get out, I guess, of his humanoid personality. So he said, visualize yourself as having a donkey head. And then he developed a different level of samadhi and reached where it was.
This morning in our little yoga class,
yes,
I was talking about visualizing having many arms.
Oh, cool! Oh, really?
You know, the potential of visualizing. This is in, you know, tantra across the board.
Of course.
You know, Shaiva, Vaishnava,
Jaina tantra too.
Jaina tantra, and everything, you know, is up, you know, for grabs.
Right.
A lot of traditions, you know, that male practitioners will visualize themselves as goddesses,
mm-hmm.
you know, everything. And then, but it'll switch back and forth. But it's quite...
Richard, in those practices, do they also visualize themselves as the female in union with a male?
Yeah.
Because that, I think that's the most difficult part. It's not difficult for me to visualize the male, but always the trip up for me is...
Yeah, to visualize, yeah.
So it's good practice. It's really good, but that's kind of where I stick. I get it for a little bit.
Well, they have these amazing things where they have a certain type of lock in the union. It isn't a normal thing. It's they make a certain type of lock. It has some name I forgot. I know. But then what happens is that the energy goes up each one's central channel equally, kind of. In resonance, you know, and back down and up and down like that. So it's a very different from the normal ejaculatory emission or female orgasm, where then they sort of dissipate the energy. They hold the gentle thing holds the two central channels openings together in a certain way, and then the energies go back up and down the two like it becomes a double ball of luminous fibers, if you will, and it must be amazing. Next slide. To be more vascular to do that. all the plants are mice and men. I would be like a truck driver in like Sahara. Or on another planet. I mean, you know, I'm very still fascinated with this idea that we are already made of light, our bodies. You know, the shell of the meat and the bones and everything is like around, it's made up of like some kind of constructed, which are really great though, because in a way it was there to teach us sensitivity. It is the light, you know, we just be flowing in and out of each other or something like that, because we'd be just these light things everywhere. And we would not, the self-other thing would be, you know, ignored. I once had a thing, we would all be in the formless realms, or the immaterial realms, in a way, because we've all had many lifetimes to be yogis, and it's a big escape, you know, from pain, you know, seemingly. But somehow, this sensitive meat space thing, the sensitive nervous system, this soft skin, the whole thing, is there to sort of relate to the other, and to deal with the whole issue of compassion and overcoming self-centeredness and selfishness. It's really something marvelous, actually. Yeah.
Well, they say that the gods, you know, who live in nice hotels, and great thing. They compassion isn't really their specialty.
The what?
Compassion.
They have to
be born here in kind of Middle Earth,
yes,
realm in order to like really start to understand.
That's right.
You know,
and there,
consequences.
And the, yes, and the Vimala, that's in the Vimalakirti Sutra. Where even they're already bodhisattvas in a Buddha land, and then they learn that they really have to come back to an earth, a Shakyamuni type of earth, where what is called the Buddha land, this land is the Shakyamuni's Buddha land, is called Saha, which means tolerable, to be tolerated. Saha, it's a form of something that means to be tolerated. Mm-hmm. And so they learned that where they were in this incense universe, perfume universe, their bodies were made of perfume, and the Buddha was perfume, and the Buddha didn't talk, he just radiated perfume, and they'd go into samadhi, the trees were perfume, and the land was perfume. They were this great cloud of sweet smell. And they were in huge samadhis, but no compassion, no suffering nearby them, no one to reach out to. And so they were really bored. And when people could send someone to their universe, they wanted to go back to this universe. And when they got here, they hated it. They thought it was so grubby. And they had to. It was explained to them that actually this is the better one to evolve in. I don't know if they bought it either. It doesn't say. Somehow we're in this challenging place, but we can do tremendous. That's the preciousness of our life in this world. We're in a world where Buddhas are like enfolded around us, want us to like make the right turns, do things. And here we are in Menla. There should be 1,000 Menlas in this country. That would be great. I wouldn't even mind if he invested, he could have a Trump Menla. And then he might go there himself and get a little bit loosened up in the life. He shave off that weird thing.
Yeah,
and be like, he could be like a monk, lose a lot of weight.
Lose a lot of weight.
Huh?
Yeah, another Trump Menla on the Mediterranean.
That's right, I said.
It would be the greatest Menla.
Oh yeah, I'd get some grape preserves. You have to sample his own wares, and he might shape up. I'm sure his family members would be relieved to send him there. Anyway, okay, let's go to dinner. Thank you all very much. Happy Independence Day. Interdependence Day. And 9:30.